I also want to thank two pianists who are going to be working with me up here today. Kelsey Henry is a freshman music major here at Eureka College. She's a fine student, fine young pianist, studying with me, and she actually performed with me on the Cynthia Atterbury duet piano recital a week and a half ago. And so this is a great opportunity for her to run that piece one more time, which is an early classical piece. And then Sako Shimasaki Bishop, because she's now married, is a former Eureka College student. She had a piano performance degree from Eureka College and just acquired her master's in piano performance from Illinois State University. She's a very busy young lady, so we're lucky to have her even here for a few minutes. In addition to being an adjunct faculty member for us in the music department here, teaching piano and doing some accompanying, she teaches in the piano preparatory school at Bradley University. She is a staff accompanist for the Germantown Hills School District. She teaches at the Japanese School in Bloomington on Saturdays, and she has a private studio of students. So she's an extremely busy young lady. So we are very thankful to have her for what little time we have her. All right, so classical harmony. The term classic describes something that has an enduring quality of excellence. It's long-lasting, highly appreciated, very memorable, and classical music is certainly that. The classical era was 1750 to 1820, and during that time, you might think of composers like Haydn, Mozart, early Beethoven, okay, associate those composers with that time period. It was known as the Age of Reason, and it was also known as the Age of Enlightenment because it was all about intellectual thinking. Everything had to have a reason, a logic. If you think about classical art and architecture, it had a symmetry, a balance. And so it's not unusual that one of the most commonly used forms of composition during the classical era was what we called ABA form, theory students, ABA form. So in other words, for that musical composition, what happened in the very beginning was contrasted by something very different in the B section, and then that A section came back at the end. So again, we had that same kind of balance, symmetry, and many forms sprung out of that initial ABA form. But it was the composer's desire to have a balance in their music. Because composers were writing for the beauty of the music and the interest of the music was known as absolute music. It was not about emotional expression. That happened later on during the Romantic era, and that's a whole nother lecture on a whole nother day. The music of this time period was known as homophonic music. Homophonic basically means that there's a simple melody that rides over the top supported by harmony below. Now this was very different than the polyphonic music of the Baroque era, which many of you may know was many independent melodic lines that occurred at the same time. So you can imagine how complicated that was because no one line of music was any more important than any other line of music. So what happened when those multiple lines of music, independent melody lines, were performed together, they created harmony that changed almost every beat. So it was very complicated, very complex. During the homophonic writing of the classical era, harmonic change was much less frequent. Sometimes the harmonies would not change for four beats or even eight beats of time. So a much simpler type of harmonic progression to support the beautiful melodies. As we talk about harmonic function during the classical era, I will use some terminology and I'm just going to briefly go through some of those terms so that it makes sense to you as I'm using some of these terms. A composition is composed of seven basic elements. Those elements are melody. And for all of you, melody is the tune that you remember when you walk away after a performance. It's what stays with you. It's actually a horizontal series of pitches that sound one at a time. That's a literal definition of melody. Harmony, of course, is a vertical collection of pitches that sound all together. Okay, an example of a harmony would be that. Multiple pitches, different pitches, that sound together at the same time. Harmony supports the melody, enhances the melody. All right, then we have rhythm, and rhythm is the pattern of the beat. You all know what the beat is in a composition. So the rhythm is the longs and shorts that comprise that beat or divide the beat to give us some interest in the music. Then we have tone color. What is tone color? Tone color is what the composer wrote the piece for. Did he write the music for the singer to sing? Did he write the work for orchestra? Did he write the work for piano? What did he write the work for? So it's what makes the sound, what he had in mind to make the sound of his composition. And then we have texture, and texture again ties in with harmony. Texture is the thickness or the thinness of the sound. This would be a very thin texture, because you're only hearing two sounds at a time. There you're hearing multiple sounds at the same time, so that's a thicker texture, okay, for that definition. Then we have tempo and dynamics, and tempo and dynamics are basically markings in the music that a composer puts there to instruct the performer as to exactly how he wants his music to be performed. When we're talking about tempo, going back to that beat, we're talking about the speed of that beat. Does he want that beat to be a quick tempo or a very relaxed, slow tempo? Okay, so he gives those instructions in the music. And then dynamics, that is applied to the gradation of sound in a work, from the very, very softest sound to the loudest sound. And those dynamic changes in a composition can be very sudden, or they can be very subtle and gradual to add interest to the work. So those are our elements, or our building blocks of a musical composition. Now, harmonic function evolves from melodic tendency. Wow. Okay, so we need to talk about melody just a little bit. When a composer sits down to write a melody, he is first of all selecting a tonality. Now, by tonality, I'm talking about a series of notes, a scale of seven different pitches. You might know those pitches as do, re, mi, fa, so, la, ti, do, right? And then we're back to do and we start over again. So seven different pitches. He's limited to those seven different pitches in that tonality. Now those seven different pitches occur over and over again. For example, on the keyboard, there are the seven that I played, and then above that it starts over again. There's seven more, and then seven more, and then seven more. And those same pitches occur in the lower register as well. So there are multiple locations of those seven pitches. All right. Those pitches, individual pitches, all have a tendency to move in a certain direction. This is when it really gets interesting. I think it gets interesting. All right, so if I give you, for example, the beginning of Joy to the World, I stopped on scale degree 2. Where do you think scale degree 2 wants to go? It wants to go to scale degree number 1. Of course, you know that tune, so you know where it goes. But scale degree 2 really does want to go to 1. And it sounds very final there. It kind of feels like, ah, I'm home, when you get to that pitch. Going on, their scale degree 7, it really wants to go to 1, an octave higher, right? Okay, and then we have in this tonality, scale degree 5. And 5 really wants to go to 1. Five to one, very, very strong tendency. used over and over and over during the classical era. So you're probably thinking, okay, everything wants to go to one. Well, ultimately, yeah, everything does want to go to one, ultimately. But other tones of the scale have optional tendencies where they want to move other directions. For example, scale degree 3 really wants to go to 4. And scale degree 6 really wants to come back to scale degree 5. And so on. So there are some options. And a composer's success in writing a melody a lot of times is based upon his success in moving from tone to tone according to its tendency. Now, all that being said, we are going to start moving into how we build harmony out of melodic tendency. But before we do that, I'm going to have Kelsey Henry come up, and she and I are going to bring you into this early classical period and perform a work by Johann Christian Bach. Now, Johann Christian Bach was a member of the famous Bach family that you're very familiar with. His father was Johann Sebastian Bach. Johann Sebastian Bach had 20 children. That's a lot of children to put through college. 20 children. Okay, his first wife had 7 children, and I believe of the 7, 3 of them lived to adulthood. After she died, he married a woman 17 years younger than himself, and she had 13 more children. 13 children. Of those 13 children, 7 lived to adulthood. Okay, Johann Christian Bach was the 11th of the total 20. Because Bach was in his, I believe, mid-50s-ish when Johann Christian Bach was born, even though Johann Christian studied music with his older brothers and with his father, by the time he was a young man pursuing a career as a composer, he was writing in the early classical era. So his music was very different from his father's, which was more in the polyphonic writing that we talked about, whereas Johann Christian was more in the homophonic writing. So we are going to play the first movement of his two piano, four-handed duet. This is a sonata, and we're only playing the first movement, and it's in G major, and hopefully this will kind of bring you into this classical time period. Thank you. Okay, you'll find it quite interesting that Johann Christian Bach was one of the first composers of his time period that preferred to write for the piano. Not this one, that one. He liked the idea that he could compose music for an instrument that would respond to the dynamic markings that we talked about earlier that he wanted to put in his score. The keyed instruments that came before the piano were the harpsichord and clavichord, and some of you might be familiar with those. They have a very, very charming sound, but it's also a very small sound. So really, to appreciate a harpsichord or a clavichord, you need to be in a small parlor-type space gathered around the instrument, and then it's quite lovely. But Johann Christian Bach wanted to write for an instrument that could respond to all of the contrasts that he wanted to put in his score. So we have the piano now coming to be during this classical time period, and it had a totally different mechanism on the inside in terms of how the sound was produced from the harpsichord and the clavichord. Harpsichord and clavichord on the inside had a quill mechanism. So when you push down a key on the instrument, it didn't matter how much strength you put behind that strike of the key, the pluck of the string with this quill would be the same, kind of like plucking a guitar string. Okay, so they were very limited in terms of dynamic contrast with these instruments. The piano has a mechanism on the inside, referred to as a hammer. Okay, and you automatically think of strength with a hammer, correct? So the strings, horizontal to the ground, are struck from below by a hammer mechanism. So when you strike the key with strength, you get a loud sound. If you strike it very sensitively, you get a very soft sound. Okay? Pretty good, keyboard. Okay, so Johann Christian Bach wanted to write for piano. That was his preference. He lived most of his, he was born in Germany, and he lived most of his youth and into his adult years in Germany, but then he took a job in England. And there he was serving as a composer and an instructor. And while in England, he met a very young Mozart who was traveling, touring. He was a child prodigy musician. So as a very young boy, Mozart, meeting Johann Christian Bach, was really impressed with his literature. The two shared multiple ideas in the music that they wrote. And it is believed that Johann Christian Bach was one of the most important influences on young Mozart. So guess who the composer is of the piece we're going to play a little bit later on? Mozart. So we can draw a little bit of a comparison between those two, but there are a lot of similarities. What I'd like to do is point out some of the commonalities between the two works, so you can kind of think about that when you hear the second work, and I think you'll realize, okay, there were a lot of shared ideas between these composers. And you also need to know that one composer taking an idea out of another composer's work and embedding it in his own was okay. They were flattered by that. They were honored that someone would take their melody and embed it in their new composition. That would not fly today, but back then, that was okay. All right, so here are some of the commonalities that you will hear between these two works. First of all, the use of a turn. A turn is a form of ornamentation. You can think of it as a decoration of a pitch. And what you do, instead of just playing the pitch, you approach it from above, then play the pitch, go below it, and back to the pitch. Instead of just playing the pitch. And in the Bach that we just heard, here was the use of the turn. Without the turn, not nearly as interesting. Okay, so that use of the turn, right off the bat in the Bach work, you're going to hear it right off the bat in the Mozart work in this way. And so on, rather than just... You're hearing the decoration of those pitches, which adds a lot of personality to the work. Another commonality between these two composers in particular was the use of a broken chord. Now, a chord is multiple sounds struck at the same time. And composers during this time period would choose to use accompaniment lines where they would break those notes apart, but they would do it with a rhythmic pattern or an even division of the beat, which we heard right off the bat with the Bach as well. And you're going to also hear that in the Mozart. The interesting thing about these two composers is they chose to do that in the treble part of the instrument. Most times you would hear classical composers putting that kind of an arpeggiation, is what we call it, in the bass of the instrument. The melody would ride over the top of that. But these two composers both put it in the treble part of the instrument. Another commonality between these two composers, and actually every classical composer, was the use of Alberti bass. How many of you have heard of Alberti bass before? Okay, Alberti bass is another form of breaking up a chord, but the difference is you play the bottom note, then the top note, then the middle note, then you go back to the top note. You all know this tune. Yes? Yes? Okay. What happens in the left-hand part in that keyboard work is Alberti bass, okay? Domenico Alberti was actually not a classical composer. He was writing in the latter part of the Baroque era, but when the classical composers got a hold of that technique, they all used it, very popular. So you'll hear that in these works, but again, with both of these composers, they put it in the treble, which is kind of interesting. So in the Bach, here's what you heard. You'll hear. Oops. Again, putting that type of accompaniment line up in the treble part of the instrument. And then we have the use of imitation. And imitation is just exactly what the term implies. It's taking an idea, a musical idea, and imitating it by another instrument or another voice, another instrument in the orchestra, whatever. But an idea passes back and forth between the performers, in this case, from one keyboard to the other. If it was for a solo pianist, it could be from the right hand to the left hand, okay? A lot of times they would imitate on a different pitch level. Sometimes they would imitate and repeat exactly what the other part had just played or sung, depending on the situation. And when that happens, it's referred to as antiphonal, kind of a call and response, which you're going to hear quite a bit of in the Mozart in a little bit. And this is an example of that. One instrument would play this, and the other one would do back to the first, and the other one back to the first. And it's at a quicker tempo, but it's immediate, back and forth and back and forth, which was really a unique idea in that time period. Asako, I'm going to ask you to run around. I have for you, well, first I'll say this. If somebody tells me about a meal they're preparing and they have a wonderful dish and they start talking about all the ingredients and how delicious this dish is, my immediate reaction is, okay, I'm tired of hearing about it. I want the recipe. So Asako is going to run around and pass out a handout for you in case you want to dabble with this a little bit on your own. It's something for you to take away as we start talking more about harmonic function. So it's a yellow piece of paper. And if you leave it here, you're not going to hurt my feelings. That's all right. Okay, so while she's doing that, I would just go ahead. As we said, harmonic function evolves from melodic tendency, and we all know what melodic tendency is now. When a composer chooses that tonality, he's got that scale system of notes to write his melody. He also then has a bank of harmonies or chords that we call triads because there's three notes in each one. And there's a triad built on each degree of the scale. So you have your scale. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, when you start over. And then on each step of that scale or each scale degree, we have a triad. There's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, and then we're back to one. Now the quality of these chords is different depending on the scale degree. Some of them are major, which we kind of identify as being bright, cheerful, happy sounds. And some of them are minor, which we think have maybe a more mournful, sad, darker, mischievous, mysterious something. Okay, and the seventh one, which I think sounds like a train whistle, is what we call diminished, and it's probably the harshest sounding chord. We use it, but it's probably the harshest sounding one of the bunch. Okay, so you have that bank of chords to select from to support your melody. The primary triads are 1, 4, and 5. 1, 4, and 5. Back to the one. 1, 4, and 5. Oh my goodness. They are the basis for so many church hymns. They are the basis for boogie bass lines. That's one. That's four. Composition, and it's much longer than what I just played. 1, 4, and 5 support most ragtime pieces. The Christmas carol we started with. Only 1, 4, and 5, the primary triads. One, four, five. Not terribly innovative, but it works. When my theory students do their first harmonic writing, you wouldn't believe how many assignments come into me with just 1, 4, and 5 chords, because it works. They're a little bit hesitant to dabble with some of the other harmonies. All right, the next one is descending fifth root movement. Wow. Descending fifth root movement. Now, what we're talking about is if you start with any chord built on that scale, and you drop 5 notes to the next chord, a fifth below, that works. And if you go from that chord to the next chord, a fifth below, that works. This is when we all start counting on our fingers. So let's say on your sheet, I believe the little illustration I have starts with a 1 chord. All right, from a 1 chord, 5, from 1, we count down 1, 7, 6, 5, 4. 4, 3, 2, 1, 7. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3. 3, 2, 1, 7, 6. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. 2, 1, 7, 6, 5. 5, 4, 3, 2. And we're back. We've done a complete circle, and that works. Better yet, combine a little bit of 1, 4, and 5 chords, your primary triads, with the descending fifth root movement. Slam dunk, that works. All right, the third option is going from any harmony, any triad, to another one that shares 2 common tones. Okay, so we actually would be descending by thirds, you could think of it that way. Or we could ascend, we could go the opposite direction. But that would sound like this. Your one chord, going down 3, 1, 7, 6, to your sixth chord, 6, 5, 4, which is kind of the basis for that little tune that every elementary piano student learns and loves to play 26,000 times. It's also the basis for most 50s tunes that you've heard. That descending third, or going from chord to chord, that shares two common tones. That was a third choice. Classical composers, they came up with all of these ideas, they loved these ideas, and they repeated them over and over and over again. And that's why so much of their music sounds like so many other classical composers' music, because they relied on those same chord progressions that were successful. They knew that they would work. All right. Oh, and by the way, that 1, 6, 4, 5. Don't ever play that in my classroom. That progression you're going to hear in the Mozart, and it sounds like this. There it is. 1, 6, 4, 5. And it happens again later on. It works. All right. So the harmonic function served as a basis for the writing, the composition at that time. It's still a basis for a lot of the writing that's done today, a lot of the composition. The genius, not so much maybe in those harmonic progressions, but in the beautiful melodic lines, the addition of the ornamentation, the rhythm patterns that they came up with, but falling back on those same harmonic patterns, that was insurance that their work would be successful. So keep in mind the commonalities between these two composers. When you listen to the Mozart, I'm gonna have Asako come up and play the Mozart. And I'll give you just a little bit of background about the Mozart. Oh, good, we're in time. This is Mozart's Sonata in D major. Mozart lived from 1756 to 1791, so he was right in the meat of the classical period. He wrote this work for two hands, four pianos, and it was one of the few works that Mozart wrote that was fully intact. An editor did not have to add missing measures or finish the work because the ending wasn't there. It was fully intact. There's no authentic date associated with this work, but in a letter that Mozart wrote on November 24th of 1781, he said that he had written a composition to perform with one of his most talented students. It was, in Mozart's words, a duo sonata, which I wrote expressly for the occasion and which met with a resounding success. We think he was talking about this work, and he was obviously very pleased with the work. Ernest Hutcheson, in his book, The Literature of Piano, which is an excellent book, it's an excellent resource, it has just tons of information about composers, their style, their successes, their failures, specific information about works, and where they were performed the first time, all kinds of details in this book. It's an excellent resource. He says about this sonata, "The sonata in D for two pianos, a masterpiece of antiphonal writing, that call and response back and forth, remains to this day the best composition of its kind." And with the performance of this piece, we will close. And if you have any questions afterwards, don't hesitate to come up and ask. And if you would like to hear even more music today, senior Lydia Presley, piano performance major, is doing her senior recital in McAllister Hall in the chapel at 7:30 this evening. She is performing works by Beethoven, Brahms, Debussy, and Bartok. And you are all welcome to attend if you would like to attend. So here is Mozart's Sonata in D major, This is the third movement. Join us for some refreshments? Yes.